Morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. Now we turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the Scottish Social Housing Charter, November 2022, from Patrick Harvey, the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. And Mr Harvey is accompanied today by Michael Boal of the Scottish Government's Social Housing Charter and Regulation Team. I welcome Mr Harvey to the meeting, and before I open the session to questions from members, if anyone has any, I invite him to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to colleagues. I'm here to provide an update on the actions taken following my attendance on the 1st of March when the committee considered the revised Scottish Social Housing Charter. In response to the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee's query about our consultation with secured creditors of registered social landlords or their representatives, the Accounts Commission for Scotland and the Commission for Equality and Human Rights, I can confirm that we wrote to all 8 statutory consultees in the Housing Scotland Act 2010 to ensure that there was no dubiety about the compliance with the duty to consult on the Charter. We sought their views on the revised Charter and provided the same 12-week response period in line with the original full consultation. We received responses from all statutory consultees, including secured creditors of registered social landlords, UK Finance, the Accounts Commission for Scotland, Audit Scotland, and the Commission for Equality and Human Rights. The overwhelming response from all the statutory consultees was that they were content with the changes that had been made to the Charter. In light of some additional comments they provided, we made some further minor changes to the version of the Charter that the committee considered in March. We've added to the equalities outcome the need for landlords to eliminate discrimination and advance equality of opportunity. We've revised the wording of the quality of housing outcome to provide additional clarity. And we've changed the value for money outcome from a standard to an outcome and highlighted the legal requirement to consult tenants on rents and service charges in the supporting narrative. I trust that these actions provide the committee, as they have the DPLRC, with assurances of compliance in relation to consultation with statutory consultees in the review of the Charter. The Charter and the regulators' reports provide an improvement framework for tenants and landlords to assess and compare landlord performance, and it's encouraging landlords to improve to deliver improved services for their tenants and other customers. Finally, can I just once again, as I think I did in March, place on record my thanks to officials who've worked on what has proved to be a highly successful tool for the improvement of services in the social housing sector, as well as to all those in the sector and others who've engaged with the consultations. And I hope that the committee is content with the revised Charter and that it will recommend that Parliament should approve it.
I thank the Minister for his opening statement. Do members have any questions? Nobody has any questions. I thank the Minister for his evidence today, and we now turn to agenda item 3, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M05578 that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Scottish Social Housing Charter November 2022 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that motion S6M05578 in the name of Patrick Harvey be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are all agreed. So thank you for that. And the committee will publish a report setting out its recommendations on the Social Housing Charter in the coming days. And I now suspend the meeting briefly to allow a change of witness. The fourth item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government on the Affordable Housing Programme, which is part of our pre-budget scrutiny. Shona Robison is joined for this item by Scottish Government officials Alistair Dee, who's area manager, and Colin McBean, who's a deputy director from the More Housing Division. And before I open up the session to questions from members, I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement, if she'd like.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's good to be here, and thanks for the opportunity to engage with the committee this morning. I think there can be no doubt that recent times have been challenging and continue to be challenging, whether it's COVID, into the cost crisis, which of course is pushing millions of people into poverty. The Scottish Government is wholly committed to doing all we can to tackle those immediate pressures, but our levels of mitigation are of course constrained, and we need the UK Government to take wider action to increase our budgets or grant us greater powers to borrow. We're already having to find £500 million in savings across government to focus resources towards tackling the cost of living crisis. And these include savings from areas where we consider there is least impact on public services and individuals, but these choices have not been easy and will have consequences. We are committed to an emergency budget review process to both identify funding to cope with inflation-driven cost increases and aim to support those who most need our help during this crisis. This, of course, is the harsh reality of a fixed budget and limited powers. But despite this, we have put in place measures worth almost £3 billion this year. And in the programme for government announced, we'll seek to introduce emergency legislation that gives renters security through a rent freeze until at least March 2023 in both the private and social sectors. And this legislation will also include a moratorium on evictions. We'll be presenting a housing bill later this year to improve affordability over the longer term, with new and strengthened rights for tenants and taking action on short-term lets and preventing homelessness. The Warmer Homes Scotland programme will also support households to install energy efficiency measures, helping reduce energy costs and usage. All of this support goes hand in hand with delivering more affordable homes, and I'm proud to say that Scotland has led the way in the delivery of affordable homes across the UK, with 111,750 affordable homes now delivered since 2007, over 78,000 of which were for social rent, including 19,339 council homes. £3.6 billion is being made available in this parliamentary term towards the delivery of affordable homes, so we can continue the important work we started in 2007 of ensuring that everyone in Scotland has a warm, safe, affordable place to live. I was given a timely reminder of the importance of good quality affordable homes as part of my recent summer visits, and speaking to tenants is a great way to understand firsthand how important it is that we continue with partners to deliver affordable homes and contribute to the delivery of national outcomes. We know that a smaller number of homes can make a huge difference to rural and island communities, and we're taking forward the development of our Remote Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan to meet the housing needs of those areas and to help retain and attract people to those communities. We recognise the continuing external market conditions of inflation and supply chain impacts, and are committed to continue to work closely with all our housing partners to help mitigate these pressures where possible through the operation of our flexible grant system. And I can't conclude remarks this morning without acknowledging the struggles being experienced by the people of Ukraine. And we've extended a warm Scots welcome to them. And Scotland is currently accommodating almost 20% of the total of Ukrainians in the UK. We do recognise existing temporary accommodation challenges and that these may be impacted, but we must and will continue to work hard to reduce the numbers of all people in temporary accommodation. So I look forward to engaging with you this morning on the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. I know there are many challenges facing delivery, but I believe our strong established partnerships and flexible systems that we have will enable us to continue to make good progress. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that opening statement and setting a range of aspects to the topic out for us this morning, and we have a number of questions that can take that conversation a bit deeper. And before I bring in other members, I'm going to lead with a theme around targets and meeting needs and placemaking. So something that's come up quite a bit in conversation with stakeholders is the question around the target delivery of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. And the question of how did that target get set and what evidence is it based on? And in what way does it relate to local assessments of need and also in relationship to the housing needs demand analysis process, is that fit for purpose for giving us that information?
Thanks, convener. So the target was initially formulated as a result of the overarching work undertaken in the development of Housing to 2040, which of course is our long-term housing plan, which initially set out the ambition to deliver 100,000 affordable homes by 2032. And in setting the target, we also considered the previous target housing need and the views of the sector, and the programme for government in 2021-22 increased this amount to 110,000 affordable homes across Scotland by 2032. I was keen, after having discussions with stakeholders from covering rural Scotland, to include a target for rural homes. I thought it was important to drive that ambition within rural Scotland. We know there are additional challenges, and I'm sure we'll come on to talk about some of those, but I felt having a specific target would help to drive developments within rural Scotland. So that really emerged from those discussions, and of course an important part of the Bute House agreement. In terms of the relationship with local government, that is clearly hugely important given their role as the strategic housing authorities, and they're best placed to make local decisions and reflect the particular nature and characteristics of their local area. And that, of course, feeds in then to the national plan and national targets. All of that led to a target that we feel is ambitious but also deliverable. The housing need and demand assessment is undertaken at the local level, allowing for consideration of local information and circumstances that go beyond the national projections and housing numbers, and that includes things like tenure, size, type, location of housing, as well as considerations such as affordability and specialist provision. So it is a valuable tool in the process. We need to keep targets under review, and we're intending to carry out a review at the midpoint to 2032 to assess if the current plan should continue unchanged or to be adapted. So hopefully that answers some of your
questions. To some degree, yes. I just I'm still a little bit not that clear on what the evidence the target is based on. If we go back to the original 100,000, I really appreciate your additional number of 11,000 in terms of driving rural and island homes, because that's absolutely crucial. But in terms of that original 100,000, and you mentioned that was built on a previous session's target, the previous targets was at 50,000. But I'm still not clear if we were going to point to evidence, where would we as a committee look for an understanding of how that number was arrived at?
So, as I've said, really it's born out of feeding in from the strategic housing plans from local authorities and the consultations with local authorities and the RSLs, really, to make sure that the target is, it has to be ambitious, but it has to be deliverable. So there's no point in us plucking out a target out of thin air that then isn't deliverable. So, you know, we've had calls to go further, but actually, whatever we do has to be deliverable. And that target is stretching the 110,000 with 10% in rural Scotland is stretching, not least in the current climate of the pressures on costs. But I think it's important that we have got quite a stretching target, and therefore, you know, that taken together, I think it's a target that is fit for purpose, but we've got to keep it under review, and that midpoint is going to be important to be able to assess the progress towards the target. And I should also say, it's not a target that you meet by breaking down to 2032 into individual years and deliver the same in each individual year, because the challenges will change and costs will change. So it will be a target that is met in peaks and troughs, really, as we get to 2032. So the midpoint is important to see the progress that's been made and whether or not there needs to be changes at that point.
Thank you very much for that. So continuing along the kind of meeting needs aspect, so in a previous evidence session, the committee heard about the challenges of providing the right homes in the right locations. And for example, in previous written evidence, Highland Council said numbers alone should not be the sole determinant, though they are a useful target or ambition. Government should be honest enough to question whether a lower but more focused number may be more appropriate. In short, the right homes in the right place, of the right size and the right tenure, at the right time and for the right people, adapted as required for needs, is arguably more appropriate and may lead to a lower total number being more appropriate. And I'm just interested to hear what your view of that statement is.
Well, we do need to have homes in the right place, of the right size, of the right quality, but we also need to deliver more homes. So all of that is a balancing act. And I do think the quality of homes that are being delivered by both local authorities and the RSLs is of high quality. And that's important. It's important that there's good insulation, that we have energy efficient homes. Does all that mean that we need to have fewer? I don't think so. I think it's a balance of being able to deliver at scale, but being able to deliver quality. Now, we're looking, for example, at the modern methods of construction, off-site construction, whatever you want to describe it as potentially ways forward of being able to get as much out of the investment, not just of £3.6 billion, but of the additional investment that brings, of the sector raises to add to that £3.6 billion, to make sure that delivers as much as possible. And we are talking to the sector and local authorities about those innovative ways of build, which can be done all year round, for example. So there's economies there. But also looking at, for example, the number of house types that there are. Do we need, 50 different, two-bedroom, three-bedroom, four-bedroom types of properties? Or can RSLs and local authorities come together to perhaps hone down on a smaller number of house types that then can go through planning more quickly? All of these things are important, and looking at perhaps operating on a more kind of consortium basis when we're delivering homes. Housing England actually have done that quite successfully, and we should be looking at ways of being able to drive efficiency in the system without compromising on quality. So these are all things that we need to look at to make sure every pound that we invest in the Affordable Housing Supply Programme is going as far as it can to deliver as many good quality, energy efficient homes in the right places.
Thank you very much for that. I'm now going to continue the same theme but bring in Annie Wells with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The committee heard from the SFHA on the need to progress with the review Housing of Varying Needs Design Guide, which has been in place over 20 years. Can you update the committee on progress with the review and comment on how it might help address the delivery of homes for those with particular needs?
So first of all, it was set out in Housing to 2040 the importance of the Housing for Varying Needs Design Guide. And the guide, I should say, still provides an excellent standard. So it's not the current guide isn't providing that. It is. But we want to review the guide to help better meet the needs of an ageing population, help people to live in their home for longer, learn lessons from the pandemic by recognising, for example, the importance of outdoor space and space for home working or study. We have really had to take some time in doing that to get it right, to ensure that the guide is going to be fit for purpose. So that has taken a bit longer, to be honest, than we would have wanted. But I think it's a balance between time and getting it right. So the latest I can tell the committee is that we plan to formally consult. There's been a lot of informal consultation with stakeholders. We plan to formally consult on the proposed changes to the guide in the spring of next year. So it is a bit of a delay, and I'm going to be honest about that. But I think it has been worth taking more time to get that formal consultation right. So meantime, there's nothing wrong with the existing guide, but getting the new guide right has taken a bit longer than perhaps we would have wanted. And I'm happy to keep the committee updated as we move that work forward.
That's great. Thank you very much for that. Just one more, convener. Given the emphasis is on placemaking in the draft NP4, how are you making sure that the new homes approved through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme contribute to these aims?
So in drafting the National Planning Framework 4, the planning system will shift to be more directive about the quality of places, including by guiding where new development should happen and how those developments can deliver more for new and existing communities. It proposed strengthening planning policy for affordable homes. It essentially, I think, provides a better, a more positive, encouraging system for affordable housing, not just in urban Scotland, but in rural Scotland as well. So I think I was asked about this actually at the Community Housing Trust event I did in Inverness, and planning came up quite a bit in the discussion. And I think what's important for us in government, we don't always get this right, but what is important is that all of the policies face in the same direction. So we have our very clear ambitions for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, but that's only going to be as good as being able to get the land availability and the planning system right. So we need to keep a really close eye on the operation and practice of the new framework to make sure that it actually does deliver on making it easier to deliver affordable housing. Now, that doesn't mean that it still has to take into account all of the concerns you would expect, but it should be more proactive in supporting affordable housing.
Thank you.
Thanks, Annie. And we're now going to move on to theme two, which is around financial capacity of social landlords and balancing priorities. And I'd like to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
Thanks for your time this morning at the committee. Some witnesses to the committee have highlighted the challenge of investing in the important aim of decarbonisation, and both the aims of decarbonising the existing stock and building new homes achievable without compromising tenant affordability.
Yep. We are asking a lot of the sector to do all of these things at the same time. And we need to ensure that we support RSLs in doing that. I should first of all say that the RSL's financial performance remains very good and robust. So we're starting from a good position, but we are asking a lot of our RSLs, and you know, as I say, we need to be very cognizant of that. In terms of going forward with decarbonisation of the existing stock and new homes being energy efficient and of a high standard, we need to ensure that that is done in bite-sized pieces. So we've asked social landlords to focus on sort of fabric first, while we're getting in place all the important building blocks for taking forward the major investments in decarbonisation. We have also been very clear that tenant affordability in all this is key. So we've said that decarbonising the existing stock and building new homes, that we have to do that without compromising tenant affordability. So it can't be done on the back of tenants' rents. So that requires us, and as you'll be aware, there's been a lot of work in terms of the task force looking at finance and how we finance all of this in a way that is deliverable, affordable, and doesn't put the onus on tenant rents and being able to deliver all of that. So it is a challenge. We've provided some quite significant funding so far, but I think we've also said we know that that's not going to be enough to do everything that needs to be done. So we will need to work very closely with the sector as we take forward all of the changes that are coming over the next few years, and we need to support them in doing that.
Thank you for that. It's very much a challenge. The Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers in evidence emphasised the need to listen to existing tenants before determining priorities. How did the Scottish Government consider the needs and priorities of existing tenants before setting the affordable housing supply targets?
So we do rely on local partners to be consulting with tenants. As a government, we set the budgets, we set the targets in collaboration with local partners. Now, I meet with tenants' organisations directly on a regular basis and hear their views, but we expect some of the detail around the housing plans, the consultation of that, to be done at a local level by local authorities and registered social landlords. And they do that on rent levels on an annual basis. They're required to do that. It's one of the requirements. So we would expect them to have the reach into communities and local tenants' organisations that would be impossible for us to have that reach. So while we do our bit at a national level, we expect that local consultation to happen.
Thank you. You're bringing forward emergency legislation to freeze rents, and this is widely welcomed, not least with the Scottish Housing Regulator highlighting that a survey of the National Panel of Tenants showed that 7 in 10 were concerned about the future affordability of the rent. You will be aware that the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations have suggested that the freeze will impact on the ability to meet targets for building homes and decarbonisation. What assessment has the Scottish Government made on the impact a freeze on social sector rents might have on affordable housing development plans, and will this mean a need for increased subsidies to minimise the risk to delivery of the target?
So there's a lot in there. As you are aware, we've taken what are exceptional measures and exceptional circumstances with this emergency bill. We'll lay out the detail, obviously, to Parliament in short order. We have made clear that there, within the bill, these will be temporary measures to the end of March next year. But what we have said is that anything beyond that, which is where the social rented sector will have its concerns, I guess for lack of another word, in terms of what happens from the 1st of April next year in terms of social rented sector rent levels. So what we've said is that we will work very closely with social landlords on whether a cap should be applied on social rents from the 1st of April next year, and if so, what level they should be at. Now, in doing that, we need to take cognizance of the economic circumstances between now and then, and to have regular reviews of that, because you know, it's the circumstances of tenants being able to afford their rents that is driving, has driven us to take this action, and the wider economic circumstances and challenges that, tenants have is going to be a key factor in what happens from the 1st of April. Now, given what happened last Friday and all of the impacts on interest rates, on inflation, all of these factors have to be taken into account, and that itself will have an impact on the social rented sector in terms of their borrowing costs. So these are all factors we need to take into account. But one thing is absolutely clear. We are going to work very closely with the sector, because anything we do, we have got to be very careful that that doesn't interrupt the investment plans that the sector have, because those investment plans are what helps deliver, along with local authority investment plans, the affordable housing supply programme. So we have quite a lot of things to balance here and get right, and that's not going to be easy. But we are very aware of the concerns of the RSLs. I've met them on a number of occasions already, as has Patrick Harvey, as the Minister, taken forward the emergency bill, and we will continue to work very, very closely with them to make sure that we support them. Now, you mentioned subsidies. Again, that is something that we will discuss with the sector in terms of shared risk, who carries the risk, what can government do to support them. We also need to, and officials have been meeting with UK Finance, because we're very aware it's not just the social rented sector, but it's their lenders that are important here, to have confidence in the sector here in Scotland to want to continue to invest. Now, they will also be affected by some of the decisions by UK government last week, and we have to take that into consideration in the round. So I guess what I'm saying is I can't tell you here and now what will happen on the 1st of April, because we can't predict what the circumstances will be like. But we are going to work very closely with the sector to try and get it as right as possible, taking all of those factors into consideration.
Thank you. One thing that came up in the evidence that's driving the cost is Brexit. And Professor Ken Gibb from the University of Glasgow highlighted as a concern about the economic change associated with Brexit. He said that Brexit is a contributory factor to the negative impact on the labour supply and the cost and shortages of materials. Is this a concern that you share, and how are the Scottish Government considering the impact it is having?
Yes, it is an impact alongside a number of other impacts, but yeah, it's had a direct impact on labour supply, on materials, at a time where those are then exacerbated by global supply issues that we are aware of in terms of the war in Ukraine, COVID. All of these things have created a very, very difficult environment. So we've been working with the construction sector. Ivan McKee has been leading work around the support to the construction sector. These are global factors. It's very difficult for the Scottish Government to resolve them ourselves. But what we can do is to look at, for example, the development of local supply chains. So the importance of SMEs in Scotland in terms of how do we create more local supply chains. That's not going to happen overnight, but it's important that we look to do that, to have more stability in the system that isn't as buffeted in the future by external factors. If we can get that that stability and resilience is the word I'm looking for, more resilience in those local supply chains, and that comes back to looking at, you know, local timber supplies, off-site construction, all of these things that we can perhaps help to be less reliant on global factors, but you know, it is a really challenging time for the construction sector. Having said that, projects are still coming in, and in terms of the cost of those projects, around half are coming under benchmark and half are coming over benchmark. So there are, but the good news is projects are still coming in and are still being approved, and that means that we're still getting projects, getting shovels in the ground, you know, to help towards that affordable housing supply programme target.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. No further questions.
Thanks, Marie. We're now going to move on to rural-focused questions, and I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your officials as well. Thanks for joining us. You touched upon the Rural Housing Action Plan in your opening statement, and I just wondered, in terms of the Scottish Government's plan that 10% of the 110,000 homes will be located in remote and rural communities, if you could update us currently on where the government is with that and what percentage has been delivered.
The target, so first of all, let me say that the Rural Housing Fund, the 30 million Rural Housing Fund, is there to help encourage the development within rural Scotland. So they still have access to the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, and that fund is there to try and encourage development, along with the Land Fund as well, I should add. Now, that is demand-led, so it requires local projects to come in to want to take forward those projects. So I guess in terms of the peaks and troughs that I talked about earlier on, that will be very much guided by projects that come in. So what I can say is that there has been, I think there's around 6,000 homes that have been delivered under in rural Scotland previously. But the good news is that over the first year of operation of Parliament of the new target, 1,600 new homes have been delivered in rural Scotland. Now, bearing in mind the caveat of the peaks and troughs, if that was to continue, though, it would give us quite a lot of confidence that we're seeing an uptick in the development, the delivery of homes in rural Scotland. But the caveat is peaks and troughs, so it will be dependent on those projects coming forward. And what's important about that is that there is support, and again, I'll go back to my visit in Inverness, the importance of organisations that are supporting local communities to bring forward projects, get them through the feasibility stage, get them to the submission of it. All of these things are quite technically difficult. The role of community housing trusts, I think, are quite important. And I was speaking to some of them at the event in Inverness, where they have developed a toolkit, essentially, to try and support local organisations to bring forward projects, some of which had accessed the Land Fund and the Rural Housing Fund in order to get those projects to fruition. Still taking too long, though. And again, we need to look at how we shorten some of those timeframes in order to get more of those projects. But some optimism given that 1,600 figure.
That's helpful. And I think one of the concerns which the committee has heard quite a lot of evidence, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary is acutely aware of, is the decline in the number of small to medium-sized builders who are often developing and taking forward these projects. Now, you mentioned it being demand-led. Where and what really can the Scottish Government do to support these smaller developers, especially when they're looking at developing affordable housing, which is often, in many cases, small-scale, and just the cost of unit pricing being where it currently is at?
Yeah. So, first of all, there's no hiding the fact that this is a tough time for the construction sector and particularly SMEs, really, really difficult. Some of the larger organisations, developers, builders, clearly have resilience within them because of their size that SMEs don't always have. So I don't, that is bluntly the case, and all of the factors that I talked about earlier really impact on SMEs. But the work that Ivan McKee has been doing with the construction sector and looking at how we can support SMEs through looking at local supply chains, looking at how SMEs get themselves in pole position to be able to bid for work on contracts, whether that's as a contractor or a subcontractor, is really, really important. Now, in Highlands and Islands, I think they are one of the difficulties is actually being able to have the capacity to meet some of the demands. And sometimes it's just not possible for some of the SMEs local to meet some of that demand. So we have to look at that as well. So we will continue to work as a government to look at how we support our SMEs and help them to be able to take advantage of opportunities. But some of these global factors and the cost base for SMEs is really, really, really challenging. But we'll continue through the work we're doing. I think one of the other important aspects I maybe should have mentioned around the meetings that Ivan McKee and myself have had with the construction sector has been some of their concerns about contracts and the risk sharing. So costs go up, who meets the cost of that? Is it met purely by the contractor, or is it met by the housing association or the local authority in terms of the customer? And I think it has to be a shared risk. So we clearly as a government don't get involved in contracts. That's for local partners to resolve. However, what we did do was we met with both the RSLs and councils and with the construction sector to put out a message about flexibility, that in order to make sure contracts and projects continue to come in, there had to be that level of flexibility. And I think that message has landed with both the construction sector and the customer at the end of the day, which is our RSLs, as we can navigate through these quite challenging times.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I wanted to further pursue a point Marie McNairn raised with regards to actually, you know, forecasting and financing for housing associations, because housing associations are quite clear that the impact of the Scottish Government's rent controls will be them having to look again at their 10-year financing and projects, whether or not they will be affordable to come forward. So given this committee will not actually see the bill till next week, and the chance to consult with wider stakeholders hasn't been there, I just wondered what impact assessment on this have the Scottish Government undertaken to look at whether or not this will potentially pull the plug on many of these vulnerable potential developments?
So first of all, I recognise the concerns, and I absolutely do, and that's why I've spent a lot of time, as has Patrick Harvey, in discussing these issues with the social rented sector, and we're establishing the way that we're going to work through with the social rented sector going forward in terms of establishing a joint group between officials and the social rented sector to work through these issues in more detail. I think it's fair to say, first of all, the vast majority of social sector rents were already set until the 1st of April 2023, because they set them earlier on in the year. So the issue that the social rented sector is concerned about is what happens from the 1st of April, rather than what happens with the bill in the next few months. And it's also worth saying, of course, that the rent levels in the social rented sector are considerably lower as a starting point compared to the private rented sector. So the power that is the bill, obviously I'm not going to give, it's important that Parliament sees the bill when it is published, but essentially the question will be whether the powers and mechanisms within the bill extend beyond the end of March next year. Now, I said earlier on all of the factors that we needed to take into account, and you know, you've mentioned the issue of rent freeze, and I don't underestimate what the social rented sector are saying about that, but they'll also be really concerned about interest rates going up in terms of their borrowing and the costs of that. So it's not just this issue, but all of which means we have to be very cognizant of their investment plans and reassuring UK Finance and the lenders that Scotland continues to be a good place to invest in affordable homes and the social rented sector. The financial stability of the social rented sector is very good in terms of their financial position. So that's a good starting point. And as we go forward, we will balance all of that with the sector in terms of their investment plans, but also, importantly, the affordability of tenants, of being able to pay their rent, and the economic climate over the next few months. So all of these things are, I guess, things we will have to balance up with the sector in order to make sure that tenants are supported, the sector continues to deliver on its investment plans, and you know, we will talk to them about whether, you know, what government's role is within all of that to give confidence. So I'm sure these are matters we will continue to discuss in some detail, not least once the bill is published, but please be assured that, you know, we are spending a lot of time working with the sector through these issues because we recognise the importance of them.
Thank you for that. And given what you've said in terms of this having to be a timed intervention of 6 months, we've just passed the charter which provides that framework for rents to be discussed between housing associations and their tenants. Why have the social housing sector been included in this bill? Because it sounds like this is going to create more problems for them over this 6 month period than it needed to.
No, I think it was important for fairness that it applied to both PRS and the social rented sector, and also it sets the framework for anything that happens post March. So yes, we're looking at the 6 months, but the levers are there in terms of what potentially would happen beyond the 6 months. And it's also important that we are, you know, the social rented sector, you know, looks as it has already done and will continue to do, of what it can do to support tenants. It is very much every time I have had a meeting with the social rented sector, whether as individual RSLs or with the SFHA, the thing that strikes me is their absolute determination to support their tenants. So whether that's through minimising any rent increases, but also making sure their tenants are aware and are supported through any rent arrears that they have, and you know, avoiding eviction as a very, very much as a last resort. So the social rent sector are already doing that and will continue to do that, and it's really important that they are. And of course, where government has taken other action to try and support the sector and tenants directly through increased support through DHPs and being able to look at not just rent arrears, but support for energy costs through that mechanism, you know, and the tenant grant fund, which we're pivoting towards, you know, cost of living, and we'll continue to keep that under review through the emergency budget review. So, we are looking at how we can support tenants to avoid rent arrears, but also to help tackle rent arrears where they do arise. So it's not, this isn't the only action we're taking. There's a lot of other supports as well.
Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. I'm just going to come back and scoop up one more rural question. I think being Highlands and Islands MSP, I'm particularly keen to get a bit more information on that. So it's really clear from what you've been saying that you are aware of the importance of the rural housing enablers and community-led housing to develop new affordable homes in our rural areas. We had Community Land Scotland in earlier giving evidence, and at one point during that session, they said that there are unnecessary complexities in the funding, and I think they're referring to the Rural and Island Housing Fund, in the funding and planning processes, which, if addressed, could speed up the process and enable more communities to deliver hyper-local schemes that meet local need. And I'm just be interested to hear what you have to think about that statement, and also in what way will the forthcoming Rural and Remote Housing Action Plan address these issues?
Yeah, well, I was just about to say the action plan has to address all of those issues, and the stakeholders, key stakeholders, have been very clear in raising the issues that you've just articulated and others in terms of what needs to be done. So, you know, they have really been informing the development of the plan. We will make sure that in going forward, whether it's about trying to reduce the timelines that I talked about earlier on of getting projects from initial conception through to spades in the ground, that we shorten those as much as possible, that the capacity of support to local communities is there. All of the myriad of issues that we know the plan needs to resolve. Having said that, it is reassuring that we are seeing more affordable homes coming through from rural and island communities. There's a 25% increase delivered in 2021-22 compared to 2020-21 is cause for optimism, with all the caveats of peaks and troughs, but it is cause for some optimism that things are improving. But I think the plan will help to keep that momentum going. Organisations like Community Land Scotland are important in terms of listening to what they're saying and making sure that the plan addresses those issues.
You'll be aware of we hear in the committee, I hear, is that there's about £110,000 that communities need to come up with before they can even access the money available in the fund. And I just wonder if that's being considered in the plan, and then also I'd be interested to hear what the timescale is for the plan.
Yeah. So that kind of feasibility stage is an issue that is being addressed. It's been raised on a number of occasions. I can tell you, Convener, that we expect the full plan to be published in the spring of next year. But prior to that, there's some priority strands of the work which I would be able to give an update before then, probably towards the end of this year. And I'm happy to write to you, Convener, with that, if that would be helpful in advance of the full plan being published.
That would be very welcome. Thank you. We're now going to move on to a new theme, the theme of grant subsidy benchmark levels and progress with delivery. And I'm going to invite Mark Griffin to lead on those questions.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
The grant subsidy benchmark system exists, and obviously you know there's a flexibility in there for those to apply for amounts beyond the benchmark. I just wanted to know if the government has given any consideration to increasing benchmark levels in advance of the formal process in April 2023, given the levels of inflation just now in the construction industry, and to avoid the delays that can happen when applications are subject to that extra level of scrutiny.
So I think just the first thing to reiterate, and I know you've probably heard me say this before, that you know benchmarks are not grant rates or grant ceilings, and really shouldn't have a role in shaping expectations of grant funding levels for any particular project. They're really a tool for determining the appraisal route for grant applications. And as I said earlier, half are coming under benchmark, half are above benchmark in terms of the project approvals coming in. The current set of benchmarks will be adjusted to account for inflation using the differential between the Scottish Social Housing Tender Price Index for the year to December 2022, which is populated by data received from RSL and council-approved projects. I'm just wondering whether, Alistair, do you want to come in on any further detail beyond that?
Yeah, I was going to sort of say it. I mean, obviously, when the working group took place sort of last October, it did look at sort of certain sort of circumstances where, you know, they would review the benchmark in advance of the next sort of expected increase. I think at the moment, the benchmarking system, as the Cabinet Secretary said, has continued to deliver projects across Scotland. I mean, some have been at or below benchmark, some have been above. And the expectation is that the information that we receive through housing tender returns for every project that's actually approved this year, because that's actually given real-time live data, which can then sort of feed into the progress, and we can compare that against the benchmarks, and that will then result in us updating the figures for the 1st of April 2023. So that then will bring it forward to allow a new set of benchmarks to be in place. So that work will probably be beginning shortly. I'm not entirely sure of what the sort of timeline on that is, but certainly the plan is to sort of start that work so that it is in place for the start of the new financial year. So, like I say, at the moment, the benchmarking system is allowing projects and is continuing to see projects sort of moving through. But as you sort of pointed out at the beginning, some will have slightly more scrutiny than others. I mean, very much the benchmarking system is a sort of an administrative tipping point, is how I would sort of describe it. So, say, for example, in my team, stuff that comes in a benchmark, we can just sort of just check the accuracy of what's been discussed and submitted, speak with the RSLs or councils, and just move that through almost immediately. Stuff that comes above benchmark, we will obviously look at in a bit more detail, which is understandable given the amounts of money that are going into individual projects. We will have dialogue, but you know, this is not causing a massive delay in any way, shape or form. It's just really a case of actually just looking and understanding why these sort of prices are where they are, and then we can just move it through. I mean, I have not, and I'm talking about the southeast area of Scotland that I manage, I have not rejected a single approval that's kind of come in on that basis. It's just a case of a bit more scrutiny if it's above benchmark.
Okay, thanks for that. And Cabinet Secretary, you talked about roughly half of approvals being at or below benchmark and roughly half being over. Is that the proportion that was anticipated at the start of this programme? Is that a sign that the benchmark system is working, or is that generating you know, a higher volume of work than anticipated and those more detailed scrutiny of those applications over benchmark?
I think given the backdrop of all of the pressures that we've heard about earlier on, of the costs, labour costs, supply costs, I'm actually quite comfortable with those figures. I think I certainly had a worry for a while when I could see kind of the Brexit, COVID, you know, global factors all pressing down on costs for projects. I had a worry about whether we would still continue to get projects coming in under benchmark, to be honest. So the fact that half are still, there's a bit of a geographical variation to that, actually is perhaps better than I might have envisaged at this point, given all of those pressures. Now, we need to keep an eye on that going forward, but I think it's not a bad position to be in at this moment in time. And the important thing is that we're still getting that flow of projects, which is crucially important as we keep momentum going on the programme.
Okay. The other issue I wanted to touch on in terms of the benchmark is the differential between RSLs and COSLA. And, you know, this has been a sore point for COSLA for a long time now. You told us last year at committee that the differential was because of differences in availability of borrowing between RSLs and council. And basically, I just want to ask again, is that, you know, is this ever going to be resolved to council's satisfaction? Is there ever going to be parity in benchmarking?
So as you've described it, it was quite a contentious issue with local authorities very strongly saying one thing and RSLs very strongly saying another. And I think the revised benchmark struck the right balance because it reflects quite a significant closing of the gap between council and RSL baseline benchmarks. But the differential, as you've pointed out, was because of the different borrowing opportunities still open to councils between councils and RSLs when delivering the programme. And I think it would have been wrong not to recognise that. So that's where, you know, we landed in terms of getting that balance. So we recognised, you know, that there was an argument for closing the gap, but that there should still be a differential based on those that borrowing. Now, I think given the continued pressures around, particularly on the social rented sector and the RSLs, I think probably that was the right decision, but we'll continue to keep it under review and listen to all representations, but I'm quite comfortable with where we are at the moment.
Okay, thanks. Finally, convener, and just a question about the social housing tender price index that you mentioned, just to ask your views on whether you think, given everything else that's going on in the world and UK in particular with interest rates and inflation, whether that's a robust enough index that gives you a robust enough data set to really give RSLs and councils the confidence that they will be able to meet the costs to build the homes that we know we need.
Maybe Alec, could I bring you back in, Alistair, on the index? Is that okay?
Yeah. I mean, as I sort of said earlier on, every project that gets approved that's a new build project, we require what's called a housing tender return, and that gives, you know, absolute live data on what's happening in the sort of sector, whether it's up in the sort of Highlands and Islands or whether it's in sort of East Lothian or wherever. You know, so it's as close to being pretty much finger on the pulse sort of stuff as we've got, and our grant recipients, the councils or the RSLs, are going in there and working through these sort of contracts and getting, you know, the sort of best price that they can get, and actually supplying some very, very detailed information to us, which then goes into the BCIS, who then produce the index, and the index is sort of divvied up on a geographic basis, so you can kind of see that. So, in my opinion, it's a system that's been running for many years. It's kind of tried and trusted. It's understood, and it's, you know, the fact that it's kind of got this sort of live data, I think, is really, really strong. As the Cabinet Secretary and others have sort of said, I mean, clearly we're in unusual times, but, you know, on the basis of a system that's consistent around sort of Scotland and provides a sort of consistent data set, I think it is a strong sort of way of looking at these things.
Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Mark. And I'm now going to bring in Paul McLennan.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning.
Just wanted to touch on a little bit on about affordable housing supply statistics.
showed a slight decline in the number of approvals from quarter one 22 compared to quarter one 21. Really just to see if, what your thoughts are on that, if there's any specific reasons, and obviously this, I think you touched on before around about trying to get to the 110,000 figure, and will that impact on the budget also?
So clearly COVID had a big impact in terms of, well, the pause of construction, and then all of the issues that we've talked about during the course of this session, Brexit, all of that has, you know, did lead to a drop and then an increase again. It's that peaks and troughs. Yeah. External factors are going to, as we go forward to 2032, are going to continue to impact. I mean, you know, the announcements last Friday and the kind of shock to the markets, increase in interest rates, etc., will be another, you know, impact. We just won't see it for another year until we see the, you know, the figures. So the peaks and troughs, which is why I talked about that midpoint of review to 2032, to just take stock of where have we got to and whether that we would then need to kind of back end any catch up that might be required if should we have those impacts. Now there was another bit to your question that I've just forgotten.
It's about the budget that's been in.
The budget, yeah. Yes. Importantly, the budget. So we have the resource planning allocations that we gave, the 5-year allocations. Are the allocations of 3.6 billion? It was important to give that certainty over the 5 years. I know that we're not always able to give kind of multi-year allocations for all the difficulties in budgeting that we all understand. But that has made quite a difference in being able to give that certainty, that is able then to help those plans go forward so that they can generate through their own borrowing the added value to that 3.6 billion, and in some cases it's a doubling in projects of the funding of that. Having said that, we're always looking for new sort of innovative ways of financing the affordable housing supply programme. So we've looked at how we use financial transactions to the best of our ability, and we've used £134 million of financial transactions funding has been allocated to the budget in 2022-23. They're quite complicated, the use of FTs, so it's not straightforward, but it is an area where we can helpfully use financial transactions, and we have also allocated £74 million to the charitable bonds scheme in 2022-23 to provide private finance to RSLs and generate charitable donations to help increase the provision of social housing. So we are trying to be imaginative in the way that we make the money go further, if you like. But we have asked officials to establish what's called an innovative finance steering group to really look at whether there's other innovative finance models that perhaps we haven't used in order to try and grow that pot even further, because, you know, we're constantly challenging ourselves, let alone the challenge that comes externally about, you know, we want to do more. 3.6 billion is a lot of money over the course of this parliament, but we need to grow that. And yes, we can grow it through the private finance that RSLs can raise, but the contribution of local authorities. But if there's more that we can do some additional programmes, and that's what we're looking at.
No, that's really good to hear, because that's something in the committee we've discussed, and I know that probably the next question, I'll probably move on to that a little bit more, but that's really heartening to see. The next question I want to ask was around about the outcome of the target review of the capital spending review in May 2022, and obviously it mentioned about a lower expected capital settlement from the UK government of around £750 million. I don't know if you can say if that's going to have any implications on the affordable housing budget in the future. And if so, how would spending be prioritised in that regard?
So, whether it's capital monies or resource monies, the Scottish budget is constantly under pressure and increasingly so. But the Affordable Housing Supply Programme is a key priority for capital spend for the Scottish Government. So, therefore, you know, I would be, you know, confident of its position in you know, capital spending review. Having said that, you know, we've got to be innovative to look at other ways of growing that pot, and I've just rehearsed some of that because, you know, as just in terms of kind of bang for bucks, with all the pressures that we've talked about over the last hour or so, can reduce the value of the what you get for that 3.6 billion and the 3.6 billion raised by or the equivalent raised by RSLs and the local authority contribution. It all shrinks as costs go up. So we have to be front-footed in being able to look at what other finance might we be able to lever in to take account of that. And you know, when we've got those kind of the troughs and the peaks and troughs, that we can perhaps use some of that innovative thinking. Happy to keep the committee updated around the work of that finance group as we go forward. We're trying to get the right expertise around the table to look at, you know, what else might we do in that space.
Okay. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. And now I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey, who's joining us online with a few more questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I have a couple of questions for you, but one of them you partially answered just a moment ago. It was about alternative funding models that might be deployed to assist here. And you mentioned the Innovative Finance Steering Group. I think this is very welcome. One part of the discussion in the committee's business was the possibility of using pension funds as a possible source of investment. And I wanted to ask you what the government's view of that might be. There was some comment from those giving evidence that that might be risky, particularly if it was index-linked investment requiring a similar return and that impact coming through on rents as well. So could you say something about the government's view of that particular possibility of sourcing new investment for housing?
Well, I think we need to get the group is going to be established in the autumn, and we need to give it a bit of kind of latitude to look at all of the potential sources of investments. I wouldn't want to rule anything out, but ultimately it's then for us to look at what the work of the group is in terms of recommendations, and we would look at those risk issues because I'm very mindful that anything that is very directly linked on an ongoing yearly basis to fluctuations can have an immediate negative impact on rent levels, and that would not be a sustainable position for tenants to find themselves in. So so anything we do in terms of that innovative finance has to be sustainable and has to be give some security of affordability of rent levels for tenants. Now, there is obviously the area of mid-market rents, which provides an important function for those who are able to afford those mid-market rents, but they're still considerably lower than the private rented sector. So, you know, it meets a particular need for some parts of the population, and that is important. And we've seen an expansion of mid-market rents, and that will continue to be an important element. And it may be that there's some financing models that can help with that part of the market. But as I say, anything that is, we would look and apply any recommendations through that lens of affordability and sustainability.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Maybe just as a wind-up question from me, can you tell us if the Scottish Government has any views yet on the UK Government's Levelling Up Fund and Regeneration Bill? in particular, really, its various missions that relate to housing, which is a devolved responsibility, of course. Firstly, has there been any consultation with the Scottish Government on any aspect of that? And has the UK Government signalled its intention to fund any of those policy intentions?
So I've certainly, there's been no consultation on any elements of housing in relation to the bill, certainly not from my interests anyway. I mean, obviously, we've made our position clear on the bill and our concerns about the bill. I think they've been well rehearsed. And housing policy is, of course, entirely devolved. Although things that impact on housing, like, for example, housing benefit, things like mortgage tax relief, things like levers that will drive inflation and interest rates, all impact on housing. But of course, we don't have any control over those matters. But in terms of delivery of housing and the building of housing and building regulations, that's entirely devolved. And that's allowed us to develop a really quite a distinctive Scottish approach, looking at the importance of affordable housing and as a key lever of tackling poverty, for example. And one of the reasons that child poverty levels are lower in Scotland is because of the relative affordability of housing in Scotland compared to elsewhere. It's allowed us to take a different approach on things like right to buy, for example, and, you know, security of tenure, energy efficiency. So, you know, we would be very concerned if there was any move in any way to impact on that area of devolved policy. So I think it would just be one of many concerns about the kind of mission creep, if you like, from the UK government into devolved matters.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, mission number 10, as I understand it, says that all renters will have a secure path to ownership. I mean, how is that going to play out in Scotland with Scottish government policy as at the moment?
Well, I did note that the tail end of the kind of previous Prime Minister's tenure, that he had announced the extension of the right to buy to the social rented sector, to housing associations. So obviously we'll be having no truck with that whatsoever. We lost about 50,000 social rented homes when the right to buy council houses was introduced by the Thatcher government, and it's taken us a long time to replace those homes. And we are trying through kind of acquisitions and the ability of local authorities and RSLs to actually purchase off market to regain some of that territory. So the very last thing we will be doing is to open up the right to buy at all, and we would resist any attempts whatsoever of the UK government to interfere in those matters. As far as I am concerned, and the government's concerned, this is a matter entirely devolved to this Parliament, and I don't think there would be any appetite whatsoever in this Parliament, I would hope anyway, to go down the right to buy route.
Okay. Thank you very much for that, Cabinet Secretary. Glad to hear it. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. And thanks, Cabinet Secretary, for all of your responses to our questions. I've got a few little follow-on pieces. Mm-hmm. At the very beginning in your opening statement, you touched on the challenges around the fact that we don't have the powers to borrow. Could you just go into that a little bit more? I mean, you may have touched on it a bit in response to Paul McClellan and somewhat to Willie, but just, yeah, if you'd like to just give us a bit more on, you know, what would we need to really be able to fulfil the commitment to our housing, affordable housing supply programme?
Are you meaning in terms of the Scottish Government's power to borrow? Yeah. Well, I mean, the very, very limited powers to borrow and the limited scope of borrowing powers the Scottish Government has doesn't just affect housing, it affects, you know, the whole gambit of ability to respond, whether that's in terms of social security measures, borrowing through COVID, in terms of supporting households and businesses, which is what every other government did in terms of its response. We are very, very constrained, and that places huge barriers and restrictions, because it means that within what is essentially largely a fixed budget, we then have to prioritise, and spending in one area and increasing spending in one area means reducing spending in another. So that's why the fiscal framework needs to be reviewed as a matter of urgency. And I know that finance colleagues have been working with the UK government to try and agree the parameters of that. But borrowing powers are clearly have to be a key aspect of any revision of the fiscal framework, so that we can operate like it, you know, any other government. Many devolved governments and local government has more borrowing powers than the Scottish Government has in truth. So, you know, this is a critical issue, and it would allow us far more flexibility to be able to respond to the peaks and troughs, the challenges of global factors, emergency events that emerge, like the cost of living crisis. It would allow us to be able to respond far better than we are able to through a fixed budget scenario that we have at the moment.
Thanks very much for that. And I just want to say thanks so much for offering to update us on the Rural Remote Housing Action Plan. That would be very much appreciated. Also, I was interested in hearing about the setting up of the Innovative Finance Steering Group. Mm-hmm. And you said that's going to be forthcoming before the end of the year.
Yeah.
So it would be, I think we would appreciate updates on that, and also understanding the timescale. How long is that group going to be in existence, and their kind of remit would be also be something I think would be useful for us to know is happening.
OK, well, I'm happy to write to the committee with some of that detail, if that would be helpful.
That would be brilliant. Okay. Thanks very much. Yeah. OK. So I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for their evidence today. That was our final pre-budget scrutiny evidence session, and we'll be writing to her with our findings and recommendations on the Affordable Housing Supply Programme after October recess, and in advance of the budget's publication. So thank you so much for being with us this morning.
Thank you.
The final public item on our agenda today is to consider a negative instrument, Building Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. As this is a negative instrument, there's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on it. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Is the committee agreed to that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument?
Agreed.
Agreed. Great. Thank you. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the final items on our agenda in private. So as we have no more public business today, I now close the public part of the meeting.